they need to start the panel relatively on time to the panel right after this. So hello, and welcome to the Animal Rights National Conference 2017 panel, Human Overpopulation, Why Animal Advocates Should Care. I'm Maureen Cohen-Harrington, and I'm pleased to announce that this panel is being recorded by the Johns Hopkins Berman Institute of Bioethics. Thank you for joining us today as we tackle the third rail of the vegan and environmental movements. This is the first time that the world's largest and longest-running animal rights conference has addressed this topic. I'd like to thank Dr. Alex Hirschaft, founding president of the Farm Animal Rights Movement, for granting my request for this panel and allowing me to assemble these rock stars from the activist and academic worlds. 2 days ago, August 2nd, was Earth Overshoot Day, the day on which humans have used more from nature than the planet can renew in a year. This date grows earlier every year. We cannot solve our environmental problems merely by going vegan, going minimalist, recycling, switching to renewable energy, etc. There are simply too many of us. Earth reached its first billion humans in 1804. It's next in 1927. The last billion, 12 years ago. World population has doubled since 1970. This pace is not sustainable. For far too many species, we're already too late. The rate of extinction has accelerated dramatically in what geologists are now calling the Anthropocene epoch. We are likely experiencing the planet's sixth great extinction of plants and animals, and we've seen only the beginnings of climate change. Let's clear up some possible misconceptions. This panel isn't about hating life, about hating people with children, or hating children. I love life. Thank you. Some of the most powerful and compassionate advocates I know have children. Some are children. So, for the sake of those children, the ones who are already here, and for all life on this planet, we need to make some tough decisions. The longer we postpone, the fewer choices we'll have, and the worse those options will be. So let's talk. We look forward to your questions following our panel presentations. First up is Alexandra Paul. Alexandra is a longtime environmental and animal rights activist. She co-wrote and produced the film on human overpopulation, Jam-Packed. She has spoken to 6,000 Los Angeles school kids on this topic. And in 1997, the United Nations honored her for her work on this issue. In 2012, she did a TEDx talk on the issue and traveled to Sierra Leone to volunteer for Population Media Center. She and her husband are child-free by choice. Alexandra was Last Chance for Animals Vegan of the Year alongside her brother, the activist Jonathan Paul, who I'm also a big fan of. So, Alexandra.
Hi, everybody. So my name is Alexandra Paul. My name is Alexandra Paul, and I'm here to give you an overview of the human population situation. And then Leilani and Travis will tie in more into animal, environmental, and ethical issues. So this is my husband and our cat. My husband and I chose not to have any human children because I have been so concerned about the number of people on the... See, it's the first time I've given a PowerPoint. Okay, there I am. And my husband. It's our family, my cat Hallie, and my husband and I chose not to have children because I've been concerned about the overpopulation situation for a long time. Since I was in sixth grade, actually, when my Glee Club teacher, Mr. Collins, said to us to please change the words to a song we were singing. And the words were, 3 billion people in the world. And he asked us to change it to 4 billion people in the world because the world population had grown by a billion since the song was written. And I was shocked because I didn't know the population was so big. And I was even more shocked because everyone else in the class didn't look at all bothered. And now, more than 40 years later, I remain shocked. because so few people are concerned about this issue. And now there aren't just 4 billion people in the world, there are 7.5 billion people in the world. So let me give you an overview of how population has grown over time. So humans, we arrived on the planet about 200,000 years ago. So I couldn't get a slide that far, but 200,000 years ago. And it took us 200,000 years for us to reach the first billion in 1830. 200,000 years to reach the first billion. The second billion came in just 100 years. 200,000 years for the first billion. 100 years for the second billion, we're now adding 1 billion people every 12 years. And today, the world population is over twice as big, has grown twice as big in my lifetime, and I'm just 54. And my mom, who's in her 80s, the world population has almost quadrupled. So why? Why has this population grown so large in the last 200 years? Because of advancements in medicine and agriculture. We're living longer, our children are surviving what used to be a very treacherous first 5 years of life. And we also are able to grow many, many more crops per acre, so we're able to feed so many more people. We are a biological success story. Survival of the fittest, we certainly have survived. So let me show you how fast population can grow. In 1991, a storm killed 139,000 Bangladeshis. How long do you think it took just the country of Bangladesh to replace those deaths with 139,000 new births? 2.5 weeks. But not all bad news. The number of kids per family has gone down quite a lot, because in the 60s, the average number of kids per family was 5, and now it's 2.5. So it's actually been halved, which is great, right? Yay! So why is the world population still growing? Because there are so many more couples having families. 7.5 billion now, as opposed to 3 billion in the 60s. A lot of people die each day, but more than twice as many are born each day, which means that we add 200,000 people to the planet every day. Every single day. Does that sound sustainable to you?
No.
It's not sustainable, which means that at one point our world population is going to have to stop growing, right? The question is how? How is it going to stop growing? Is it going to stop growing because of disease and famine and war over resources, or is it going to stop growing because we decide to find a humane solution to stop it from growing? Now I'm all about humane, and I know y'all are too, because you're here at this Animal Rights Conference. Well, the most humane solution is for the world population to go down to 2 billion people on the planet, which I know sounds like a big drop because we're now at 7.5, but it's actually just the population of 87 years ago. To get down to 2 billion humanely, the one-child family has to become the norm. So that means that if you haven't had kids yet, choosing to have one child, adopting, or choosing not to have kids at all is the most important choice you can make for the future of animals, the planet, and humanity. Oops. Oh, yes. Right. This is it. Okay, so the green is the UN median projection. They think that the median, if we keep going the way we're going, we're gonna hit 11 billion people in 85 years, okay? Could be even more. Could be a little less if the average family size becomes 2 children, then we'll go to about 9 billion and we'll stay there for about 200 years or so, between 8 and 9 billion. However, if we choose to have an average of 1 child per family, the world population will go down to 2 billion in 110 years. I know this sounds like a radical idea, and that's because the world population has grown so fast, so quickly, and so large so recently that our biology and our culture haven't had a chance to catch up with this new reality, this new way that we have to think, which is that to survive, we have to not procreate. We have a lot of factors working against us. We have religion that tells us to go forth and multiply. Our society continues with these memes of bigger families are happy families. Only children are only children. And that you're selfish if you choose not to have kids at all. Besides religion, biology, culture, there's also another factor that's stopping us from lowering our population. And that is capitalism. Capitalism depends on more and more consumers. So whenever there's a lowering in a population in a country or region or a city, there's all these headlines saying how terrible it is. Why is it terrible? Well, because fewer consumers means fewer people buying things, and that's bad for the economy, at least in the short run. You know what's also bad for the economy? In the long run, if we run out of trees and water and space and minerals, that's really bad for the economy. If we have so many kids we can't educate them properly, if we have people looking for jobs, but there are no jobs, especially as we get more and more automated, if we have people at our borders wanting to come in because they themselves are running from famine, all that is really bad for the economy too, in the long run. But unfortunately now when people talk about the economy, they only talk about the next quarter, so they don't see these larger ramifications. A lot of people think technology will save us. And it's true that we might be able to eke out a few more of the Earth's resources through inventions, but even if we can feed and house 12 billion people, what will their quality of life be like? So at some point, the world population is going to have to stop growing. So why not start now when the population's at 7 billion and not 11 billion? And let's stop wishing that some technology is going to save us, because that technology does not exist yet, and it might not even work. Now, we vegans, we feel like we're doing our part because our diet emits half the CO2 emissions of that as a meat eater and uses a lot less water, and that's awesome. And a lot of us also drive electric cars and have solar panels, and we give money to organizations, we recycle, we compost. But the truth is that being a green consumer really is a hoax if we're adding 80 million people a year to the planet, which is what we're doing. Now, this is a graph that shows the emissions that a vegan over a lifetime will save. That's 70 tons of CO2 emissions. Wonderful. But for every child you choose not to have, you are saving 10,000 tons of CO2 emissions from going into the atmosphere. Now, in this century, 50% of the population growth is going to come from Africa. But that does not mean, and it does not absolve us Americans from lowering our family size to one, because we Americans use so many more resources than anyone from any other country, especially Africans. Now, this issue touches all walks of life. Okay? If you care about climate change, you know, we can't keep our emissions low when our population is getting so high. If you care about world peace, we can't have world peace in a world where there are more people and fewer resources. Even if you just hate traffic, lining roads is just a band-aid when more and more people are just going to keep using them. But you don't care about animals because you're here. If you really care about animals, then lowering the population to 2 billion is what's really going to help them in the long run. Do I think we're going to be able to do it? I don't know, because all I hear, especially from here, us Americans, is us passing the buck and refusing to talk about this issue because it feels uncomfortable. So I'm asking you all, as animal activists, you have ethics, you think outside the box, and you're willing to take on difficult causes. Please, please, take on this issue of human overpopulation. We need you. Thanks.
Stars. We've got two more. And I'm just also so thrilled that there are so many people in this room. This is a room I do want overpopulated, so please excuse me for a moment while I capture this. This is awesome. So to keep things moving along, let me introduce our second amazing panelist, Leilani Munter. She's a biology graduate turned professional race car driver and environmental activist. Discovery's Planet Green named Melania the number one eco athlete in the world, and Sports Illustrated named her one of the top 10 female race car drivers in the world. Quite a combo. Melania uses her race car to spread awareness among millions of fans. She's on the board of the Oceanic Preservation Society, the Oscar-winning filmmakers behind The Cove and Racing Extinction, which you may have seen last year at the Animal Rights National Conference, along with Melania. And off the track, she drives an electric Tesla Model S powered by solar. Her motto, never underestimate a vegan hippie chick with a race car.
Everybody, it is really exciting to see so many people in this room, because I was actually worried that it was going to be an empty room because people do seem to be so afraid to talk about this issue. Like Alexandra, I started thinking about this issue a long time ago. It was actually in college. I was attending UC San Diego. I was studying biology with a specialty in ecology, behavior, and evolution. And one day I came into the lecture hall, one of those big auditoriums, 300 people, and our biochemistry professor said, you know what, everybody close your biochemistry books. I'm not going to talk about biochemistry today, I'm going to show you a film about population. And he showed us a film that just, it completely devastated me. I still think about it. I haven't stopped thinking about population since that day. And I remember I walked all the way across the college campus talking with this professor about population, and it's been worrying me ever since. But like many people, I think, you know, because it is an uncomfortable subject, we don't like to bring it up. We're not sure if we're going to upset people. So I didn't talk about it much publicly. I talked about it with my friends and my family. But at the racetrack, you know, I promote electric cars, solar power, veganism. But I've only recently started to talk about population. In 2012, I started working on a film called Racing Extinction. That's about the sixth mass extinction of species. So the human impact on our planet is pushing species to an extinction level that's 1,000 times faster than the natural background rate. And I worked on this film for almost 5 years. So I'm going to show you just a little clip from Racing Extinction.
Each year, about 1 in a million species should expire naturally. In the next few decades, we'll be driving species to extinction 1,000 times faster than we should be.
In 100 years or so, we could lose up to 50% of all the species on Earth.
Humans are the driving force of this mass extinction event. We're probably doing it, you know, as rapidly as has ever happened in history of the planet.
This is a song recording of a male singing on Kauai. He is the last male of a species singing for a female. Will never come. And now his voice is gone. I think the 21st century is perhaps the most important environmental century in the human experience.
What will populate the planet 100 million years from now will be determined by what happens in the next few centuries.
How could life be slipping through our fingers? It's like having a symphony. And one by one, you just pluck each of the instruments out of the orchestra to your last voice is there. And then it's gone.
So one of the animals that's featured in, how many people have seen Racing Extinction? Okay, good number. So for those of you who haven't seen it, if you watch it, there is a scene with a photographer, his name is Joel Sartori, and he is doing something that he calls the photo arc, where he is taking photographs of all the endangered species in the world, just to sort of record this, you know, dictionary of these amazing animals that we're losing. And one of the animals that we show in the film is a frog. It's called the Rab's Fringe-Limbed Tree Frog. And he was the last of his species, and he actually died last year. So I've gone to Atlanta to meet this frog a couple of times. It's a really beautiful scene in the film, and he passed away last year. So I got to, you know, personally witness one of these species that's lived on Earth with me in my lifetime is now gone. And that's happening like thousands and thousands of times over every single year. And many of these species you don't hear about. I mean, it was, you know, medium-sized brown frog. You probably never would have heard of him if he was not in the film Racing Extinction. These species are blinking out all the time without us taking any notice. And the reality is that it's the impact of us, of animal agriculture, of habitat deforestation, pollution, climate change, ocean acidification. Every single one of those problems, those environmental problems that we face, is exacerbated every single day as we add a million people to the planet every 4.5 days. This is something I have been so worried about for so long. And when I started working on Racing Extinction, I started doing a lot of screenings for the film. And about a year and a half ago, I was in Vail, Colorado. I was the only cast member from Racing Extinction giving the Q&A. And the very first question that I got was from the audience, there were about 700 people in the audience, was there an issue that you didn't address in the film that you wish you had? And I immediately said, absolutely, population. It was not addressed in the film. And that always kind of bothered me. And I noticed that immediately when I said that, I could see like two-thirds of the audience sort of nodding and clapping and saying thank you for bringing this up. They wanted to talk about it. And about a third of the audience, you know, kind of uncomfortably shifted in their seats, and I felt them take a very defensive position. And it is scary to sort of bring up this issue because you're not sure how people are going to react to it. But I think the most important thing that we can do is to start talking about it. And that just by talking about it, it's normalizing us having this uncomfortable conversation. And then, you know, by default, that uncomfortable conversation becomes a little bit more comfortable. So I had this discussion with my husband when I met him back in 2004. And, you know, when I met him, he you know, thought maybe he wanted to have kids. And I immediately, you know, said, look, if kids is something that's really important to you in your life, you know, then we should break up now because I'm not going down that path. I decided that day that I saw my professor at UC San Diego show me that video. And the more that I've started to talk about this, the more comfortable I've become in bringing up this issue. And so about a few months after I was speaking in Vail, I was speaking in Aspen, and I decided to throw out my normal speech. My normal speech, I speak about, you know, climate change, electric cars, solar power, veganism, all these things that, you know, that I do and that all of us can do to reduce our carbon footprint. But I just decided to throw out my whole speech, and I said, you know what, I'm going to talk about the elephant in the room. Because I really felt like the environmental community was just ignoring this issue and not speaking about it. So I just talked about population, and one of the things that I said in the speech was that there are 134 million orphans in the world, children that are looking for homes that are already here on Earth. And so, you know, I was encouraging people that if you have that innate, you know, need to be a parent, you know, consider adopting one of those 134 million kids that are already here, that need parents, that need a home. And when I got off the stage of that speech, I was waiting for the elevator, and this young girl came running up to me, and she just grabbed me and she said, I just want to thank you so much for talking about the orphans, because if my mother had had her own children, she never would have found me. And she gave me a huge hug, and it was the last day of that conference. It was a renewable energy conference. They had a big party on Aspen Mountain that night, and she found me again that evening. And she had another girl with her who was also adopted. And I took this picture of us. This is us on Aspen Mountain. This is Anna on my left and Zoe to my right. And I'm still in touch with these girls. They're wonderful girls. They're doing great things in the world. And I'm now researching a possible future documentary with the Oceanic Preservation Society, the group that made The Cove and Racing Extinction, about population. And this was because we were sitting in a board meeting. We were at Skywalker Ranch in north of San Francisco. And we all kind of went around the room with ideas, the board, on, you know, what should this next film address? Do we want to focus on trophy hunting or palm oil extraction or habitat loss? All of these things, when it came around to me, I said every single issue that all of you talked about, as long as we're adding a million people to the planet every 4.5 days, it cannot be solved. And so I kind of pitched this idea that I had to Louis, you know, that this is one of the biggest issues of our generation. And it's one that people are afraid to talk about, but I do believe it is the most important issue we need to start talking about. And I know that everybody in this room, the fact that you're vegan, the fact that you're here at this conference, you care about animals. And so if you care about animals, think about the fact that, you know, all these people being born into the planet, a lot of them are not vegan. And I've seen different numbers, but on average, the numbers I've seen have been that each person, on average, eats between 7,000 and 10,000 animals in their lifetime, if you're looking at like the UK and the USA. So we know that of those million people being brought into the planet, a lot of those every 4.5 days, a lot of them are gonna be eating meat. So not only by bringing less people onto the planet are you saving more farm animals, but you're also then reducing climate change, ocean acidification, habitat destruction, pollution, all of these things that are making wild species blink out. And so you're saving all kinds of animals, and you're doing so much more to reduce your carbon footprint and make a positive impact on the world by choosing to not have children. You know, when I had this discussion with my husband, it was, you know, sort of, you know, I felt like, you know, this could be something we would break up over. And he came around, and now we are so happy that we made that decision. And now, you know, I'm learning from people like Alexandra. She's been speaking about this issue for so long. This is, you know, only my third or fourth time speaking about it. But I'm so encouraged to see so many of you here. It tells me that people are ready to talk about this, and I've had so many people come up to me and just say thank you for bringing it up. The climate change march that happened in Washington, D.C. in April, I actually carried a sign that said, 7.5 billion is enough. Thank you for not breeding. And I probably... I got a lot of funny looks from people, but I also had a lot of people running up to me and grabbing me and saying, this is the most important sign in the whole march. Can I get a picture with you? And it was the only population sign that I saw. I mean, there were 300,000 people there, so I certainly didn't see every sign. But it was the only population sign that I saw. And I felt like with that sign, it was so powerful because I was just making people think for a second about it. And the more we talk, the more comfortable it becomes, and the more that we will feel comfortable saying, you know what, I'm choosing not to have kids, and that's an okay thing. I shouldn't have to explain it. Bill Maher did a great little last word on his show on HBO, where he said, you know, he's talking about women that feel like they have to explain why they didn't have children. And he said, she doesn't have to give you an explanation. She doesn't owe you an explanation. You owe her 9,000 tons of CO2. And I think my time's up, so thank you.
Very good presentation, thank you. Yes, as you advance your own advocacy in this, you'll see, as difficult as it is convincing people to give up animal products, try convincing them to give up their idea of having a human biological child. It does take a certain level of confidence, but we do have to normalize this conversation and try to find solutions. Okay, so next up, someone who's been talking about this for quite a while, very publicly, is Travis Reeder, PhD.
He's the Assistant Director for Education Initiatives at the Johns Hopkins Berman Institute of Bioethics and the Program Director for the Master of Bioethics Degree Program. Travis's research interests tend to center on issues of procreative ethics and climate change ethics, with a particular focus on the intersection of the two, that is, the question of responsible procreation in the era of climate change. His publications have appeared in several journals on this topic, as well as in a short book with Springer entitled Toward a Small Family Ethic, published in 2016. So, Travis.
I am not used to having to follow that. I'm an academic. Most people I follow are really boring. This is intimidating. For those of you who are here just to see them, you can walk out now. Okay. So I promise I will try not to be boring. I think that Alexandra and Leilani have done just an incredible job kind of laying out the basic facts and the basic problem. You know, as a researcher in bioethics, my PhD is in philosophy, so I'm coming at this from a very different point of view, but it's amazing the degree to which we kind of came to the same place. You know, Leilani brings up the orphan crisis and the fact that, you know, here's a thing that you can do to kind of satisfy your parenting interest. My very first publication in academia was a paper on whether we might have an obligation to adopt, given the orphan crisis and the fact that adding a child adds so much to climate change and that our current population is unsustainable. And so the facts that, you know, we are all kind of taking for granted here build up to an argument. My job is to make that argument clear and to really investigate it. And that does sound boring, I promise. I'm going to try not to be boring. But so just take everything that Alexandra and Leilani said as agreed upon: climate science, biodiversity science, demography, right? Now we've got a problem. Here's a really inviting sort of inference to make at that point. Well, we should stop breeding. Or we should institute population control. Or you should not have a child. All of those are really, really big inferences. And some of them are really, really scary to talk about. Some of them sound horrible and uncomfortable. So my job as a bioethicist is to try to think very carefully about, are any of them true? And if they are, what kind of justification could we give? Man, I sound boring after that. Okay. Well, you keep going. All right, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you a really brief overview of some of the things that I've said on this topic. And the goal is to try to show you that if you take these facts as the basis for a conversation, there's a disconcertingly plausible argument for the claims like fertility reduction policies are morally justifiable, and all of us individually probably ought to think about our family size from a moral perspective. And those are really uncomfortable topics, and so I'm going to try not to be a jerk about it, right, and be sensitive. But we're just going to talk about the arguments, right? So here's something I'm going to tell you right up front, so the conversation, like the fingers are pointing. I got a kid, right? So we got a table full of like child-free by choice women who really are like able to stand up and say, not so much for me, right? I made a little Earth Destroyer, right? So I'm in the hot seat here. Okay. So with a couple of my co-authors, Colin Hickey and Jay Girl, who are recent PhDs from Georgetown University, I've written a couple of papers on a proposal that we call population engineering. And the idea is there are all these people who think we're going to have a tech fix to things like climate change. And so geoengineering, right, is the thing that's going to save us. Well, geoengineering is terrifying. Don't have time to talk about that right now, but as an ethicist, I look at that and go, ah. So here's another thing we could engineer. We could engineer the size and the location of various populations in the world, right? Now that sounds like population control. And population control has a really, really sordid history, so we have really good intuitive reasons to react negatively to that. And so what we do is we want to say, when I say population control and you immediately think China's family planning policy, the so-called one-child policy, and you think atrocities, sex-selective abortions, forced sterilizations, infanticide, those things did happen, and they were atrocities. That's not an argument, right? So if I say, should we consider population engineering, and the response is China, That's not an argument. So here's what we do. We lay out on a kind of spectrum of coercion. There are lots of interventions that we could take to reduce the global population. And the really coercive ones are at one end of this spectrum. Things like forced abortions and forced sterilizations. They are obviously off the table, right? No one is talking about we should implement those. Our point is that when you take those off the table, there's still a lot we can do that would affect the global population. So what we say is, look, the least coercive thing you can do is actually autonomy enhancing. It turns out that if you do things like, educate people, especially women where they're systematically undereducated, if you give people access to healthcare, if you improve the standard of living for people so that they have access to basic goods, their fertility rate drops drastically, right? That's not even a question of whether it's morally permissible. From our perspective, it's required by justice that people have access to basic goods. This is actually autonomy promoting, and it turns out to be a family planning policy because it predictably reduces fertility. So we think that just in the same way that there are a bunch of policies that are off the table, these sorts of policies are just required by justice. We should just implement them everywhere. That's not the interesting part of the conversation. The interesting part of the conversation is there anything in the middle of this spectrum? And if so, what might it look like? Could it be justified? We think there is. We think that there's something called preference adjustment interventions and incentivizations. And our claim is that both of these could be done permissibly. These could get kind of moral sanctioning. So what's preference adjustment? It's arguing, it's debating, it's providing reasons. That's totally above board. No one's worried about that. It's also marketing, right? People like Alexandra and Leilani, who are really good speaking and are famous for doing things, like when they say it, it sounds a lot better than when I say it. So we should make them say it, right? And when you do things like that, people predictably react better. And so we can make soap operas, we can make folk art. So Alexandra has volunteered for Population Media Center. They've made an entire NGO out of doing this. And it's incredibly effective, right? So you can change people's preferences. And this also doesn't sound like coercion, right? If you convince people that what they want is smaller families, and then they get smaller families because you've also given them access to family planning, that doesn't sound coercive. That sounds like you gave them access to goods that they also turned out to want, right? Turns out we do this for profit all the time. That's what marketing is, right? So if we do it for profit, what would be so wrong about doing it for saving the planet? That's the kind of argument we make. Okay. Incentives are the sketchiest. They're the scariest. We think some incentives are just totally non-problematic. Here's the thing we can do. Birth control, available, affordable. Family planning, counseling, available, affordable. You can pay people to take advantage of them. Pay every couple to take a family planning course. Right? Pay people to fill their birth control. Right now we say pay women to fill their birth control, but as soon as we actually get male birth control, which we should have, pay men to fill their birth control as well, right? You can make it a little bit sketchier and say things like, should we tax children for the wealthy? That's real popular. I said that in public, it doesn't go well. But right now, fairly wealthy people get tax credits for children. My first child, I got a tax for my child. My credit, when I first had her, I got a tax credit for her. And I'm a professor, I'm not rich. But by global standards, I'm phenomenally wealthy. And we got a tax credit for her. So there's actually an inverse incentive. One of the things we could do is get rid of that for level of wealth of someone like me. Comfortable. Taking away that incentive is not going to harm my daughter, right? What do you do for people who have more money than God? Well, we can at least tax them heavily and use that money to pay for things like climate mitigation and biodiversity savings, right? Offsetting. It internalizes the cost that they're imposing on the world by adding a very wealthy person. That starts to get a little bit scarier. Are we actually going to make people pay for humans? But it's still not at that radically coercive level, right? It's still not taking away choice. And we tend to think that this sort of incentivizing is permissible in other realms. My co-authors and I, we think that probably still falls on the right side of the moral line. But we understand that that's sensitive. All right. 6 minutes. We can do this. All right. So. All of that is a really quick overview, and I'm happy to talk about this all day. I'll be here, talk over beer, whatever. What if we live in the world that we actually live in, where the entire planet is not going to adopt global fertility reduction policies overnight? That would do a lot, so we have lots of good modeling data. if we adopted fertility reduction policies, it would make a massive dent in our efforts for climate mitigation, for preventing biodiversity loss, extinction events. But what if we don't? Now we're talking about this child-free by choice lifestyle. We're talking about this idea, could it actually be the case that I should limit my family size for moral reasons? It's a really hard problem because it's incredibly invasive. The question is uncomfortable. It's also the case that it can feel totally not worthwhile, right? So this is a really meaningful action for a lot of people. It's a really meaningful lifestyle. And when they do it, their kid is one of 7.6 billion. The all-time anthropogenic carbon budget, does anyone know what that number is? How much carbon we can emit all time? 1 trillion tons of carbon. So even my one kid, if the numbers are right, you know, you got the graph earlier from Alexandria that came from a couple of Oregon state scientists, even if those numbers are right, 9,000 metric tons for an initial child, drop in the bucket. Infinitesimal addition. So why should I not have a kid? Well, I'm an ethicist, so I wondered about this question, and I think that we do have really good reasons to talk about our family size. I'm just going to give you the briefest overview of the ones that I think are really important to think about. So one of them has to do with the language of virtue. And this is really old language, and we don't talk about it enough anymore, but it's been around for 2,500 years and counting for a good reason. And that's because we actually all tend to think it's important. We use it in everyday life, and we just don't seem to think it carries any weight. But a virtue theorist would say, like, you should adopt certain characteristics, and the adoption of those characteristics doesn't depend on everybody else doing it, right? You should be a good person, even if you're surrounded by, you know, really crappy humans. So I put the green backdrop here because there's a really smart philosopher named Dale Jamieson, one of my heroes, who said we need green virtues in the era of climate change because the world's not doing enough and we have to live good, meaningful lives anyway. And so one of the things that he thinks we need is a virtue called mindfulness, where every time you take an action that has effects on the planet, you kind of take the burden on your shoulders. You understand the dyeing process that went into your nice new clothes, and you understand the labor that went into your shoes, and you take the moral burden on every time you make these activities. I think he's absolutely right that we have to be mindful in an interconnected world of 7.6 billion people. But if we should be mindful, well, when you have a kid, you think about all of the other choices that you can make add up to have practically no impact on the environment compared to the choice not to have a child. Hard to be mindful and think that that's off limits, if there's one. So a really, really smart graduate student in bioethics and philosophy at University of Pennsylvania, and what she says about veganism, actually, so appropriate for this crowd, is she gets asked all the time, why did you go vegan? And it's very often in a kind of attacking way that I'm sure you're all familiar with. And she really struggled with the answer. As a professionally trained philosopher, she really wanted to know, like, how can I satisfy the demand they're giving me? And what she finally settled on is, for her in particular, it was about integrity. So there's this value of having your actions line up with your values. That this is a central moral part of existence, right? And so if your values are about sustainability and not contributing to massive problems like the next great extinction event, then acting in a way that's completely at odds without reflection seems to violate our integrity. She thinks that's a really good answer for all of our individual actions. No reason it wouldn't apply to the realm of having kids. Last one is the one that I spend a lot of time on in my own research. And this image probably looks very strange. What I wanted to get with this image is that we are all just like one person in this massive interconnected morass of humanity. And that can leave us feeling causally impotent. Right, so here's the thing about all my climate emissions. All my greenhouse emissions could, by luck, end up in a natural carbon sink. I could be the human who has none of my emissions actually harm anyone in the future. The system's just far too complex for us to know that any one of us is doing harm. And so our old morality doesn't seem to capture the sort of obligations that we have if we think we have obligations to, say, not drive a Hummer around, right? So I think we need a new morality. Instead of just concentrating on, hey, don't harm people, don't like stab somebody, which is still a good rule, but instead of just having that rule, we also need a new one, something like don't contribute to massive systematic harm. And if you're looking for a real obligation, if that integrity and virtue thing kind of felt wishy-washy to you, here's a really good moral principle that I think absolutely stands up. We evolved from small tribes, hunters and gatherers, communities of dozens and hundreds of people. And our morality arguably wasn't evolved to deal with 7.6 billion people interconnected in a global marketplace. So we didn't come up with the contribution to arms principles. It didn't matter to our lives. You had to not stab people. That was the important part. Climate change changed that. Biodiversity loss changed that. The acidification of oceans changed that. We need a new morality, and that morality has to acknowledge that it matters when you contribute to a system, even if your contribution feels meaningless. You have an obligation to take part of something that's much bigger than you. And I think you all believe this already. You recycle, you go vegan, you talk to other people about ways to improve sustainability. If you do that, you're already committed to an idea that your individual actions, I didn't think that was actually going to ring out loud to tell me I was done. You're already committed to the idea that your actions matter morally, even if they're infinitesimal drops in the bucket, causally speaking, right? That's my spiel. I'm happy to talk to you all.